Y'all want to have some fun in the Lord today? See, when we say having fun in the Lord, we're talking about attitude of gratitude. So we're going to have some fun now. There's nothing in the Bible that tells us we can't have fun in the Lord. Amen. Sermon today, we're going to ask for a little participation. Every time you hear the words, "He covered me," I want you to say it right behind me. I'm going to say, "He covered me." You'll say, "He covered me." Amen? That's all you got to do. And help me praise Him. He covered me. I believe His word to be praised. Help me praise Him. He covered me. He brought me through danger, seen and unseen. He covered me. Do you know we have the right to praise God? He covered me. I got a right to praise God. He covered me. He covered my heavy drinking. He covered me. God knows He covered my bad thinking. He covered me. He covered my bad attitude. Yeah, He covered me. Man, all up in my heart, there are some things, some bad things I wanted to do, but God knows He covered that too. He covered me. He covered me. He covered me. here in God's house. Isn't God good?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. We came to praise the Lord today. I don't know what you came to do, but I came to praise the Lord.
Yeah.
There are some things we need to know about this God today. Did you know it is a faithful saying? There is a faithful saying, for if we be dead with him, we shall also live with him. Somebody say
amen.
Hallelujah. You know, suffering produces Christians. If we suffer, we shall also reign with him. If we deny him, we also will. He will also deny us. However, if we believe not, yet he abideth faithful, he cannot deny himself. Of all of these things that I'm telling you today, church, all these things, put them in remembrance, charging them before the Lord that they strive not about words to no profit, but to the subverting of the hearers. Let the church say amen.
Amen. Amen.
Now today, the deacon is going to come up right behind me after the choir continues to praise us through song. Brother Walker is going to give us some scripture, the word of God, followed by prayer from Deacon Potts. Is that all right with the church? Amen. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Good morning, Mount Olive. How's everybody doing? How's everybody doing this morning? Do me a favor. If you can, stand to your feet. This morning, we have an opportunity to praise God. Can I get everybody to praise God? Put your hands together. God has been doing stuff for us all this week, this day, this hour. He's been blessing us continually. Even if we didn't think about it, he gave us air in our lungs to breathe. He gave us the ability to stand if you were able to stand. Even if you couldn't stand, he gave you the ability to move, tap your toe, to shake your head, maybe even raise your hands. So don't hesitate to do that while we're praising. This is corporate praise. We're going to praise him together. So I need each and every one of you, no matter what you do, if you want to just clap your hands, if you want to do a little two-step, you can if you want to. Don't be scared. Don't be scared, because I know y'all do it if you were at home. People at home, I want even you to put your hands together. I want you to sing along with us, because again, we're going to praise them together. All right?
good morning.
Good morning.
The Lord is good all the time, and all the time He is good.
Yes.
I will be reading for your hearing this morning from the book of 1 Timothy, verses 1 through 5. Chapter 2, verses 1 through 5. I exhort, therefore, that first of all, supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings, and for all that are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who will have all men to be saved and to come unto the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading and hearing, and especially the doing of His word. Thank you.
Good morning. So while you're in that same attitude, we're going to go to the throne of grace and petition the Father for our desires. So, Lord God, we just come, Father God, just humble as we know how, Lord God, which is not humble enough, Lord God, but we just come thanking you, Lord God, for just giving us another day, Lord God, that you've given us another opportunity, Lord God, to just praise your name, Lord God. Father, we just pray, Father, that we would submit ourselves, Father, to your will, Lord God, that we might be used of you, Lord God, to do those things that you've called us to do. For truly, Lord God, you want to work a work in each and every one of us, Lord. We weren't made by mistake, Lord God. We're not here by mistake, Lord God. You have a purpose for us, Lord God, but we need to submit ourselves to your purpose, Father. We need to be the clay, Lord God, to let you mold us and make us what you would have us to be, Lord God. So, Father, we just come, Father, seeking your will for our lives, Lord God, that you would continue to move, Lord God, in our being, Father, in this church, in each and every person, Lord God. For together, Father, each and every part that you made makes the whole, Father. It makes your body, Lord God. And that's what you're trying to form is your body, Lord God. But we need to be submissive to play and be the part that you called us to be. Father, we pray you forgive us for our sins, Lord God, when we don't do those things that you called us to do. When, Father, we don't spread your word, when we don't witness, when we don't live a life, Father, that's pleasing in your sight. Lord God, but you say you are faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness so that we might, Father, come to be that man or woman that you've called us to be. Father, we thank you for this family. Father, we thank you for each and every person that is here. We thank you for the word that's going to go forth today. Lord God, we thank you for your messenger, Lord God. We know your word will not return void, Lord God, that it will do its work, Lord God. But we just need to, Father, submit ourselves to that word, Father. Have our ground fertile, Father, so that we can receive it, Lord God, that it might implant itself in us, that it might bring forth life. You are the God of life, and not the God of death, Father. You are the God of life, and all that's in you is life. So if we're in you, we're life. We're not death. So, Father, we don't speak death, Father. We speak life, and we speak that life more abundantly, Lord God. We have a gift that's given by only you, Lord God. It's eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Savior. So, Father, we just pray your blessing on those that are sick, Father God. We pray you just continue to heal and to again, we lift up our pastor, Pastor Ellis, Father, and Pastor Smith, Father. We pray you continue just to bless them, Lord God. And as I said, each and every member, Father God, just bless us and guide us, Lord God. And Father, as we continue to give your name praise this day, Father, we pray that it won't just be a Sunday thing, Lord God, but it will be each and every day and every second of our lives, Lord God, that we'll realize that you are with us, that you don't ever leave us, you never depart from us. You're always there. So we should always be in an attitude of praise, Lord God. For Father, you've gave us a promise, and you don't not slack concerning your promises. Your promises are yes and amen. And we can depend on you, Lord God, in all things. And Father, be with us and guide us this day. And again, let everything that we do, every voice that we raise, be a praise unto you. Let it be a savor, a sweet savor unto you. And we'll be careful to give your name to praise.
how he said that God created us with a purpose, for a purpose. Each and everyone has a purpose to do his work. Do me a favor, repeat after me, say, God is doing something wonderful in me. We got to remember that God is blessing us and he's preparing us to do a good work for him. So no matter what you're going through, just remember that God is doing something wonderful in you.
Incredible. Baptist Church, we believe in kingdom building for the Lord Jesus Christ. That work is made possible by the generosity of our members, as well as our visitors and friends. There are several ways you can help us continue God's work with a generous donation. You can give via PayPal, Cash App, or you can even mail your gifts directly to the church. We also offer ACH and bill pay options. Please contact the church for more information. On behalf of our pastor, the Reverend Clyde W. Ellis, Jr., our First Lady, Sister June Ellis, and the entire Mount Olive Baptist Church family, we thank you for choosing to give to this ministry. We pray that God will continue to prosper you in this season and in every way possible. God bless you.
Well, praise the Lord, church family. Amen. Jehovah is your name. You know, when God spoke to Moses, you know, God told him, he said, by my name, you have never known me. Amen. You have never known me by my name. Up until that moment, he was known just as what? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. He said, but by my name in Exodus chapter 6, he said, you have never known my name. Jehovah is my name. Amen. We bless the Lord this morning that we have come to worship the great God, Jehovah. Amen. Thank you, Bithia. Oh, she stepped out, but bless God, that was Bithia. Now, if you ever want to, if you're truly, truly a Jeopardy fan, then I want you to, next time you see me, tell me in the Bible where you find the name Bithia. Who was she? Amen. She has a Bible name, so bless God for that. Amen. Amen. And I would have never known it had I not watched the movie, The Ten Commandments. I said, oh, boy, let me go research that. And sure enough, there it was. God is so good, church family. What a blessing and a joy. And also for the benefit of those that are here, in terms of our giving, as you are leaving this morning, our ushers will have a plate there at either door. So if you were not able to get the opportunity to contribute on the way in, you can do so on the way out. And I want to tell you in advance, we bless God for your generosity, for the support of the ministry here at Mount Olive. Amen. Amen. I want to invite your attention this morning to the book of 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians. Glad to have Deacon Troy with me here today. Amen. He's one of my students. Amen. Just so glad to see him. And Melissa, thank y'all so much for coming over this morning. We bless God for you. That's Deacon Anderson's oldest boy. Amen. Now, he ain't going to look up. He's going to act like he ain't talking about me. So he looking down. All of a sudden, his shoelace is untied. My shoe untied. You know he going to get me for that one. Y'all know that. Okay, he's been getting on me for many years now, and I love him dearly, I really do. But I remind him all the time when he's getting on me, you're not my daddy. But it ain't never stopped him from getting on me. He's like, Lord, please. Amen. 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Good to have you here this morning, Deacon Stacy. Amen. It's good to see. As we all know, he's in the Marines station in one of the places that we all want to visit, Hawaii. Amen. So, you know, his body might be here, but clearly his mind is back in Hawaii. Amen with you, brother. Amen. God is good. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, we're going to begin reading at verse 23. Apostle Paul, under the anointing of the Lord, bless us in this manner. He says, for I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner, also he took the cup, when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye, as oft as you drink it, in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he come. These are the words of the Lord. Thank you all so much. Thank you so much. This morning, we want to talk from a subject of the Lord's table. the Lord's table. Most of you here know that God allowed me and blessed me to be able to retire from the Army. In 1984, I was stationed in Fort Leavenworth, Kansas, and not for the long course, okay? As you all know, that's where the federal prison is. So I wasn't there for the long course. So, but I was stationed there for a season. Amen. And while there, I attended a church there in the community known as First Baptist. If I remember right, and don't hold it to my heart, but attribute this one to my head, I believe the pastor was Reverend Sprague, I believe. AJ, you remember? I believe it was Reverend. Well, one particular Sunday while there, we had an evening program, so they were going to serve a dinner in between the two programs. And I was upstairs, you know, the rest of, and I just happened to observe a young child, looked like, I don't know, 6 years old, 7 years, something like that. And she leaned on the Lord's table, you know, as children would do, you know. And it was a lady there, very dear lady, who her we called her Miss Lorraine. Now, y'all know the background of that. If you grew up in the country, every adult that you met, first name was what? Mr. or Miss to you as a child. We had a lady in the community, old, you know. My mom and dad used to refer to her as Aunt May. We, as the children, referred to her as Miss Aunt May, because that's how we were trained. So we took Aunt to literally be her first name, and we weren't allowed to say the first name of grown people. So she was Miss Aunt May to us. So Miss Lorraine, on this particular morning, she sees this child leaning against the table, and she says to her, "Sweetheart, you need to stand up straight. Don't lean on the table." Of course, the child obeyed and stood up. But as soon as Miss Lorraine turned her back, the child resumed leaning on the table. But I guess, as most mothers do, Miss Lorraine had eyes in the back of her head, because she saw this child and she turns around and says, "Honey," and, you know, of course, now being more firm, she grabs, you know, how you get you by the arm, get your attention now. "Didn't I tell you not to lean on that table?" Of course, by this time, the little girl's scared to death. But Miss Lorraine promptly begins to explain to her why she should not lean on that table, Cardell. She said, "Don't you know that this is a sacred table? Now you stand up on your own 2 feet." That was the end of that. Well, I watched this, and I thought, because I didn't get involved in it, I'm just watching, and I thought to myself, you know, pastor has a tendency to go off to the silly side. So I thought to myself, I said, "Well, it wasn't so holy when it stood in the forest." Nobody said nothing when they leaned against the tree that produced that table to me. Now, this is what went through my mind, that we had elevated this table above the person that Jesus died for. You see, what has happened is we have gotten caught up in a lot of tradition. And so the table, while not sacred, does hold a significance for us. And this is what Paul is writing against: the unlearned position that the church has in terms of what's being represented here. Not the actual article it represents to us. The Lord's table. You see, every church door that's opened this morning in the name of Jesus celebrates the Lord's Supper in many different ways. And I'm sure you have been to churches where you have said to yourself, "That's not how we do it," right? in terms of how they participate in this communion portion. I went to a church where the pastor would come down. He would stand behind the table, okay? And a deacon on either side, they had a white tablecloth that covered the table. They would pick up that cloth and hold it up so that you could not see the efforts of the pastor behind the sheet. So it was left to your imagination as to what is the pastor actually doing. So you, of course, as I sat there, I'm trying to run through my biblical bank, and I'm saying, now, where did they get that from? Well, the answer to that is what? That's the Old Testament. Because it represented what? The curtain in the temple, which was torn from top to bottom. It was torn. Jesus did what? Tore that in half. So now why do we put that curtain, this barrier between you and the elements, which represents Jesus Christ, that was broken for him? So you see, we have a tendency to go in the Bible and create these traditions. And what has happened all along then is what Jesus said has little to no meaning, because it ultimately is reduced to a ceremony. In other words, here at Mount Olive, for the benefit of those who are visiting with us, we celebrate the Lord's Supper, communion, on the third Sunday of each month. Now, that alone right now should have you in a bit of a tizzy, because you should be saying to yourself, well, that ain't when we have it. We do it on the first Sunday. Well, no, we don't do that either, child. We do it on the fourth Sunday. And on top of that, some churches actually celebrate this at night. Some of you, how many of y'all been to churches where communion was held at night? Thank you, sir. It's called, I know sometimes people say, Pastor, I'm making that stuff up. So when I was in Oklahoma, we celebrated communion on the first Sunday at night. We never would do this during a daytime, morning time worship service. So you might ask yourself, well, where did that come from? There's a whole lot that goes around this and a lot of tradition. How many of you heard of an open communion and a closed communion? You've heard of that. Well, what does the nighttime allow you to do? To celebrate a closed communion. We celebrate here at Mount Olive, if you will, an open communion. Whether or not you participate is left up to who? To you. I'm not going to sit here with a stick and go, put that down. Put that back. I'm not the guardian of your salvation. That's you. But in a closed communion, which is done at night, who goes to church at night? Members only. You never see them stop and say, let's recognize our visitors at this time. Visitors don't go to a quote-unquote night service. So this is the pastor's way of reasonably assuring themselves that every person who is participating in the Supper of Remembrance is a believer in Jesus Christ. But that's not my job. It's not my job to sit here and say who is or who isn't. That's the job of the Holy Ghost. I ain't got nothing to do with that. My job is just to teach and let him be God sometime, right? Because I don't let Holy Ghost be God all the time. You know how it goes. Because I got to take control sometime. If I didn't take control, I wouldn't have anything to, you know. But every time I take control, my knees get ashy. That's why I buy that Jergens lotion. Amen. Or get you some Vaseline one. Or if you grew up in the country, you got a little bit of what? A little bit of lard. You had to do something. Otherwise, some what, Joy? Some fat back. You had to do something because your knees would come out there. You'd be like, man, why are your knees gray? But no matter how people celebrate communion or when they celebrate communion or where they celebrate communion, the one thing that is common is the table. We call it the communion table. And you've noticed that they come in all shapes and sizes. Some of the tables are very simple in design. Some are fancy. We have one, I think, that's reasonably decorative. And some are plain. But nevertheless, there's a table. Even at the First Communion, what we call the First Communion, where Jesus was with his disciples that night, there was a table. Now, not the table in the mind as we think table, okay? When we think table, we think of a table about yay high that we sit down at. Now, they did not sit down. As the custom was, it was a low table. So they did what? So sometimes you had to help people with the image. So how many of y'all, sometime when you're watching television, you have some popcorn or some other snack, you don't typically always sit on the couch or the lounge chair or the whatever, or the recliner to eat. You do what? You lay on the floor. Kind of brace yourself a little bit and you eat like that. Well, essentially, that's what they did. They had a low table, and they would recline around it, and they would eat. That's why Jesus was able to wash their feet that night. He didn't get up and go down under the table because they were not seated at a table, but reclining at a table. So the feet, obviously, are extended. So if I wanted to wash your feet, I could easily just reach over and wash your feet. And nobody would have thought otherwise. Because washing feet was fairly typical in his times, depending. For example, if you came in the home of a Jewish member, you had to do what? Wash your feet. To demonstrate ceremoniously that you were cleansing yourself spiritually. You were purifying yourself, so you washed your feet. So it wasn't uncommon that evening that they were at this table. And they were there to celebrate a particular special meal that evening called the Passover. And so in verse 20, if you notice, it refers to that table. It tells you that they were there at that table. So today, I want us to, because see, what's got to happen, as Reverend Jay, I love when he makes these statements. He said, the Bible is not filled with stories. There's a lot of children Bibles, if you will, that we buy. And we say they contain what? Bible stories. But the Bible is filled with lessons for the believer that will help us to be all that God desired for us to be. So what's important then, because understanding this becomes foundational to your growth in Christ Jesus. And until we begin to fully embrace its significance, then it's just another table. And the reason for coming to that table, who cares? After all, it's third Sunday. And we always do this on third Sunday. No, this is not what it's all about. You see, the Lord's table is first and foremost a place where we come to remember who? Jesus. You can say it. It's a place where we come to meet and remember him. That's what he said. The whole time they were there, every bit of it, he kept saying, remember me, remember me. So if you come to the table with your mind on anything other than Jesus, then you eat and drink damnation to your soul. He said, then you do well to just get up, go some other place that serves food for the body, and feed your belly. Because this is not about your belly. See, that's what it had been reduced to in the days of this church. They saw this as nothing but a place to get a wing and a biscuit and something to wash it down with. That's why Paul told them, don't you have homes where you can go to eat? But you come here and you treat this with no respect and no understanding. If you want to disrespect the significance of the table, then to participate without understanding why you are here and what you are doing, is to bring shame on the work of Jesus Christ. He said, Paul said, for you do it ignorantly, without any understanding. When Jesus sat around the table with his disciples, he gave them the bread and he gave them the cup. Twice he said, do this in remembrance of me. When you eat the bread, do this in remembrance of me. When you drink of the cup, do this in remembrance of me. This has nothing to do with a lamb or a biscuit on the table, but it has everything to do with the death of Jesus Christ. He said simply, remember me. So short and simple, when we come to the Lord's table to take what we call communion, think Jesus. Don't have anything else on your mind. When you stretch forth your hand to participate today in the breaking of the bread, eating the bread and drinking of the cup, if you have any other thought going through your mind other than Jesus, do confess it, he said. Now, here's the trick to it, because people go, well, my mind ain't right, so I better not do this. He said, if you don't eat, you don't drink it, then what? You have no part of me. So he said, simply, see, Jesus doesn't let us off the hook. He said, square it up, make it right, so that you can participate. So if you have something in your heart that you believe won't allow you to eat worthily, confess it and make it right. So this goes back to the forgiveness. So this morning, if you walked in here with aught in your heart against somebody, before you stretch forth your hand today, you need to go in prayer. Don't say, well, Pastor ain't pray for me. You pray. You know what you did, or you know what somebody did to you. Square it up. And when you leave here, don't stop until you make it right. Make it right. Forgive, I preach, or not be forgiven. It's your choice. You can either forgive, or your Father in heaven won't forgive you. It's your choice. So I can either forgive and be free, or I can walk in a state of unforgiveness and God now has aught against me. So you decide what you want to do with whatever took place. You decide. You can't say nobody made you do anything. You just got to understand, I got aught in my heart against you. And it's okay for me to walk in a state of forgiveness. That's between me and God. Hey, brother, go do your thing, but I'm going to slide over here just in case. Y'all saw what happened about the bolt of lightning in D.C. 4 people standing, 3 people dead. So I'm going to give you some room. I'm going to give you a little bit. I'm going to give you a little extra. 6 feet? No, we're going to do 12. We're going to do 12. Well, I'm going to give you 12, okay? Why think Jesus? Because he said so. Because he said so. Remember me. Remember me. And since it's written in red, this is what we call the red letter edition of the Bible, where people sat down. Somebody came up with a good idea, because the Bible wasn't written in red with red in it. It was a good idea, where someone said, why don't we identify every word in the Bible where we believe Jesus was physically alive and walking this earth when he spoke those words? We're going to put those in red. So hence the red letter edition. So if you have a Bible with that, that's how it came into existence. So since 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 24 and 25 is in red, then Jesus himself said, it's not my interpretation. I'm not exegeting anything. I'm just reading. He said, eat the bread, remember me. Drink the cup, remember me. And every time you do this, he said, you show forth my death until I come. That's plain and simple. He is the reason we come to the table at all. Not because it's the third Sunday or the first Sunday or the fourth Sunday or at night or any other time. Because he said as often. So that says what? I can do this every day, all day if I choose. Because every time I do it, I'm thinking Jesus. You know, as you get older sometimes, you forget things and get crazy too. And I know that. But when I was in Alaska, I used to teach Bible study. And we celebrated communion at the close of Bible study every Wednesday. Every Wednesday. Every time we opened the bread, which is the word of God, to show forth honor to the one that this book, as Deacon West says, God's love letter to mankind, we will close by saying, this we do in remembrance of you. So see, it doesn't have to be the third Sunday, the fourth Sunday, there's no Sunday. Because we do this, we come to this table in remembrance of Jesus. But it isn't just coming to the table to say, I remember Jesus, I remember Jesus, I remember Jesus. It's not for that reason. There are three things in particular that we are to remember. See, this is the very essence of the gospel. I was listening to, what is that first name? What's Stanley's first name? Is it Charles? Charles Stanley this morning. And it was either look at Charles Stanley or look at Madea. So I decided to go with Charles Stanley. And Charles Stanley said, you have to make sure that you are participating or a member of a church that is teaching Bible doctrine. This is doctrine. This is the foundation of the gospel. And his name is Jesus. And it's not just calling his name, but it's remembering the wonderful work that he did for us. I teach the purpose of the Bible is to reveal the Christ, and his name is Jesus, and what the Christ did for us, which was to redeem all of mankind, period. And it never gets better than that. So when I come to this table, I remember and I focus on his suffering. See, there was a price to be paid. This salvation that you and I believe to be so free. Oh, somebody had to pay that it might be free. Because if it was truly free, then why did Jesus die? Jesus said somebody got to pay the price. For where there is no death, no shedding of blood, you still in your sins. Look at what he said. For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. He break it. Take, eat, he said. This is my body which is broken for you. And then he concluded by saying, this do. He didn't say anything about the Passover, did he? So this is not about the Passover. See, the Passover points to. So this night, the Old Testament is concluded. Jesus said, I am now setting forth what? A new testament in my blood. This do in remembrance of me. This is not about the haste in which you departed out of Egypt that night. This had nothing to do with that. This has nothing to do with killing the lamb and putting his blood on anything. This has everything to do in the same night in which he was betrayed, he would be sentenced to a sinner's death. And so Jesus said, note that the breaking of the bread then is significant. It was only, and notice it was only after Jesus broke the bread that he said, this is my body, which is broken. He didn't say which will be broken. He said, which is broken. And so it's not just the bread, but the broken bread that represents Christ's suffering in the body. Now, let me say something. Because we know that's clearly pointing to his crucifixion. So I got a phone call the other day. I was sitting in my truck, too. I It was hot out there. But anyway, when people get questions about the Bible, they just call me, and I'm happy to stop whatever I'm doing. So the question had to do with your sermon. See, you left your work undone, Minister Darrell. You got me. And the person wanted to call me to straighten it out. With a conclusion being, I think he needs to study the Bible a little bit more. I said, okay, well, that's a fair statement. We all have opinions, and that is, you know, nothing wrong with that. So the person states to me and says, well, he said, look at Lisa. Like, now Lisa's sitting up straight. She's like, see, this is when you get, see, this is, see, when you mess with a preacher, see, what you're actually taking on is his wife. See, because she done set up straight now. She like, mask down. She like, what'd he say? I want to know what he, I want to know who he is and what he say. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Look at AJ sitting on there tomorrow. I just got in trouble. So he said that when, some of y'all might remember this. He said, when you accept Jesus Christ, you become married to Jesus. Right? Now, that was what he said. He said, wait a minute. He said, now, Pastor, we know that the marriage to Jesus Christ takes place when? After Jesus returns a second time. Book of Revelation. So that's not right then to say you're married to Jesus now when the wedding takes place future. I said, okay, that's good, that's good. I said, so let me answer it this way. Jesus said, the scripture says that Jesus is the lamb slain before the world was framed. Now, we know, if I'm on Jeopardy, the answer to Jesus being slain / crucified took place when? It didn't take place before God created heaven and earth. It took place outside of Jerusalem, future. Did everybody get that? So what is God telling us? There are two things that are sure, according to the scripture, in this world that never change and cannot lie. One is God himself, and the other is his word. So when God speaks future, it's as though what he said future is happening now. So the marriage, am I okay with Melissa? Keep me straight, girl. So when you accept Jesus Christ, your marriage to Jesus future takes place by faith. And we walk by faith until the day that Jesus actually comes back and, you see? Why do you think Joseph and Mary were sweating? Because Mary was pregnant. And they were not married. Mm-hmm. So that cast a bad light on them. So either Joseph was the father of this pregnancy, and to which he's in big trouble, because being bound by the Jewish custom, he wasn't supposed to do that. Or he stands up and says, I am not the father. Huh? And he got something there where they done took a test. You know, he done been to Dana. Amen, been to Dana. And Dana said, Joseph is not the father. If that's true, then Mary is a street woman. And we don't know who the father is. Oh, but the Bible said, well, just let me clarify that thing. It's the Holy Ghost. It's the Holy Ghost. So you got to understand how the Bible is written. Everything that's future, God calls it now. Because remember, with God, there is no what? Future, no time. That's why he said, my name is Jehovah, which translates into what? I am. I am is the present tense. God is always eternally in the present tense. So you are married to God now, and you will walk by faith to the day of the ceremony. That's all it is. So here, when Jesus says, my body, which is broken, his body had not actually been broken because he was crucified after this. But when God speaks, what is going to happen future, as far as God is concerned, happens now. So his body was just as broken then as it would be when he would be crucified. That's why he told them that, which is broken for you. He hadn't gone to the cross. He was already speaking into the suffering and the death and the shedding of the blood future. And everything that he spoke that night, did it not happen? Did he not agonize in prayer in the Garden of Gethsemane? And people got that wrong. All this plays into this table. Jesus, some people thought, well, Jesus was starting to doubt. Jesus was getting weak. You're out of your mind. You can never, listen to me now, if you don't get anything else out of today, you can never associate anything to Jesus that is inconsistent with the nature of God. You cannot do that. Because that in, as the Bible calls, is to bring God down, meaning you're making him human. And God, and Jesus is God. While he took human form, by nature, he is not a human being. He is God. So why then did Jesus pray that night? Because he was getting weak? He thought he wasn't going to be able to hang in there and get through everything that was sitting before him? No. We already declared that he's the lamb slain. So when God spoke those words in the Logos, oh, he was slain in that moment, and he would be slain this night with all that goes with it, all the horror that goes with it. Listen to what I'm trying to get you to understand about him. So he prayed. It talks about drops of blood. He prayed as though his sweat was like drops of blood. You know what the Bible was trying to tell you about Jesus? Our bodies, he had a human body. Our bodies can only withstand a certain amount of stress before you blow your brains out. You can only take so much. Why do you think they pump morphine in you and other sedating drugs? Because you can't take it. And you understand what's happening to you. But you physically, it is not that you can't take it, it's your body can't take it. Because if we continue the stress level under which it is, your body itself will explode. That night, Jesus Christ had taken upon him the sins of mankind. His body, physical, would not be able to endure. So he prayed that the angels would come, not strengthen him, because he was already resolved in the Logos to be slain, but he needed his body to endure the stress and the strain that it would have to go through. Do you understand? This body can only handle so much before the body gives out. He said, Father, I need this body to be strengthened, that it will hold out, that it might endure everything that it has to when the full weight of all of mankind's sins from the beginning of time become his, where he would become as a sinner. And it all comes to place right here. This body says, my heart can't take that. It's physically can't handle that strain. It's beating madly. When my daddy died, I asked the doctor, I said, "What happened?" He said, in English, because I didn't need no doctoring language, he said, "Because your dad had suffered a massive loss of blood, the heart has one job. And what is it? To circulate that blood, pump that blood. But what if the amount of blood needed to sustain you is insufficient?" In other words, you're supposed to have this much blood, and you, let's say you got that much blood. Now the heart is saying, "Oh my God, we got a problem here. This guy has insufficient blood," because it's doing what? So now the heart says, "We've got to get what we have around where it needs to be." Now the heart is doing this, and the heart said what? "I can't sustain that. I cannot sustain that level of beating, that pumping. I can't sustain this." So the pump does what? Stops. Physically, it just said, we call it a heart attack. He said, "Your dad's heart could not keep up with the demand." So the heart just says, "I'm out of here. Y'all do what you got to do, but I'm done." That was it. That was it. That's our body. And if someone doesn't intervene and do something, whatever that something is, your body gives out. Whatever it is. How many of your parents, grandparents ended up on dialysis because the kidneys said what? "I don't want to do this no more. I don't want to do it. And I ain't going to do it." So it stops. We call it renal failure. Just quits. And if you don't do something artificially to continue to remove the toxins from the blood, the purpose of the kidneys, then the body says what? It goes into sepsis, becomes infected, and you die. That's it. That's what happened to Jesus that night. His body said, "I can't do it. I can't sustain until all is fulfilled." Because remember, he had to continue in that body as long as it was God's will for him to stay in that body. Then the body has to be able to sustain. This is what Jesus did for us. We got to put a picture around this thing. Remember, he had to die on God's watch. He couldn't die on our watch. That's why they were going to break his legs. God said, "Oh, no, you're not. Oh, no, you're not." Because had they broken his legs, then his death would have been hastened by man. God said, "No, he has to die on his own free will. He has to come out of the body at the time that God designates, and not a second before." So the body had to hang in there, Simon. Man, that body was ready to give up. But God's will sustained that body until all had been fulfilled. Then Jesus said what? "Tetelestai," which is translated what? "It is finished." Because everything that God had ordained had been done. Every jot, every tittle had been satisfied. Now it's dying time. And with that, what did Jesus do? Ordered his own spirit out of his body. "I'm out of here. I got to go. It's a wrap." And when they got to Jesus, wanting to hasten his death, what did they say? "He's already dead. He died on God's time. He didn't die according to a man's will." This is what we have to understand. All of this played out that night for him. The unlawful arrest, the unfair trial. This is what we remember. See, Jesus didn't just go to church on a lovely Sunday morning dressed up in his regal deity. No. He got there by way of a betrayal. He got there by way of his disciples' denial. and all of mankind abandon him. All these, I'll do this for you. Where were they now? The brutal treatment. I always say it this way. They beat him like a dog. They beat him in an inhuman way. And when they finished, you could not recognize him. He had been beaten viciously. And this is what Jesus wants us to understand when we come to the table. He says, take, eat. This is my body broken for you. This is what we remember. This is what we focus on. And as I eat, you know what happens to me? My eyes fill with water and my heart begins to cry out, thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Lord. Because had he not done it, you and I would have had absolutely no reason to come here this morning. We do well to have done something else, because we are in our sins and we're going to be judged to a devil's hell. So all that Jesus endured would have become ours. That is your future. That's why people are scared to death to come to what we call a funeral. The box scares them. I hope everybody goes to a funeral and they look at the box and get scared. If nothing else, it should scare all the hell out of them. Because then they understand that what happened to Jesus. So you might want to take a step back and say, oh, I think I'll just let Jesus have that experience. Meaning, I believe in Jesus. He then did what? He took that cup. And after that, in the same manner, he gave thanks. And he took that cup and told him, this is the cup of the New Testament. In my blood, he didn't say nothing about a lamb. Because he is the lamb slain. And it is a reminder to you. Because in the Bible, symbolically, when any time blood is shed or poured out, it represents what? Death. And not just death. It represents a violent death. That lamb, the real lamb that was slain, you think that lamb stood there and said, cut right here, get right here, give me right here. No, you took that lamb against his will. And you took that lamb in there to the priest. And against that animal that was shaking, trying to get loose for you, you slit his throat. And then captured the blood that you might apply it. That's a violent death. That's what it symbolizes. So he's showing them this evening, I'm going to die a violent death. I'm not just going to be standing on the cross. Whenever you're ready, Father, you know, just go ahead and pull that plug. I think I'm just about ready. No. So this cup reminds us that Jesus not only died, but Jesus was executed for crimes that he did not commit. How do we know Jesus did not commit the crimes? Because the man who judged him said, I find no fault in this man. No fault in him. But because the people demanded his death, they took him and violently executed him. They drove nails. That's got to hurt. You just got to believe that hurt. That hurt. They drove nails in his feet. That hurts. And in order to breathe while you're hanging, because what's holding you on that cross? You. So in order to breathe, you have to raise your body up to take a breath. And then you sag down to exhale. So every time Jesus took a breath, he had to pull himself up by the nails that were in his hands. That hurts. So ultimately what happens on the cross? You suffocate because you can't breathe. You can't raise yourself up in order to breathe. So that's why they break your legs. Because I kept thinking, why did he want to break his leg? They broke his legs because then he can't pull and push himself up anymore. So he just hangs on his weight and suffocates. That's what they were trying to do. But they didn't have to do that because he had already committed to fulfilling his Father's will. I keep telling people, I say, you know what? That shows you the devil didn't understand God's plan. If the devil had left Jesus completely alone, had never intervened, Jesus would have gone to the cross because that was his Father's will. So what the devil was doing was hastening the Father's will by doing all he could to get Jesus to the cross as soon as he could, not realizing that his death would be our salvation. So if the devil had understood that, he would have done all he could to keep Jesus alive. You see, he didn't understand. He outthought himself. So Jesus says, every time you come to the table, remember God has given you a gracious root word, grace, meaning you don't deserve to be here. You honestly don't merit what Jesus has done for you. You should die in your sins and be cast into a devil's hell. But it's not God's will that any of us should perish. God said it doesn't work that way. So he said, as many as receive what he did, when they come to the table, shall be saved. And so God now issues all of us a gracious invitation. So our response should be, thank you, Jesus. Because even to come to the table is not of yourself. See, we always want to think that somewhere in this we did something. But God says, no. Even coming to the table, coming to the knowledge of what Jesus did for us is not of yourself. It takes God to draw you. The Bible says God draws you, and those whom God draws, the Son will save and set free, and the Holy Ghost will seal you until the day of redemption. It takes God to cause you to come here to cry out, save me. That's why we thank God for everything today. When we come to this table today, everything about this table, how we get to the table and what has been accomplished is all of God. That's what makes it of grace, not of yourself. You can't claim any of it. What you can claim is that gift, the gift of salvation through Jesus Christ. So from this moment on, you are responsible. Every time at least you come here to Mount Olive on the third Sundays, for you now understand. You can't say you don't understand. You can't say, oh, it's the third Sunday. This is what we do here. Can't say that anymore. You say, no, it's to show forth his death until he comes because we remember Jesus and his gracious invitation to come. Come, he said, unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. You see what it's all about? This is what God wants. That's why Paul says you have to eat with understanding. You must clearly perceive the truth of coming to the table. And you don't come to the table because it's the third Sunday in August. That's not it. He said, and just to show you that it's not the table itself, he said, as often as you do it. So I don't care where you are. I don't care where you are. You're trying to show forth what the Lord has done for you. It could be any place it needs to be. Was it last month, Brother George? July, a handful of us were over at the bowling alley. Now, I know y'all said, Pastor, what did we do once, well, once y'all finished bowling, Pastor can't bowl, what did we do? We had communion. We circled. Am I right, David? You were there. We gathered in a circle, and the deacons had brought the communion elements with them, and we distributed those elements. And then all the brothers, we joined hands, we prayed, and we gave thanks. Well, all we had done was bowling, and we gave thanks. And we said what? This bread is broken in remembrance of Jesus. And then we took the cup, and we said, this is the cup of the New Testament and his blood shed for me. And we remembered Jesus. Had nothing to do with a piece of furniture, but it had everything to do with what? The heart and soul of a man. Because this is the table where we meet him at, right here. Right here. You see, saints, did everyone pick up the communion elements upon arriving? You should have been able to get those as you came in. If you did not, just raise your hand. And our deacons will make sure, did I see a hand? Right back. Could I get one of the deacons to go? There's a hand. Fred, are you seeing? Okay. Anybody, there's about three hands or so back there. One right here. Make sure everyone. And as we prepare to participate, we do so in remembrance of Jesus. And all that means, his suffering, his death, and our salvation at the table. At the table. At the table. God is good. Go ahead. And help prepare our hearts and make a good choir.
The blood that Jesus shed for me.
Thank you.
that night, when he had given thanks, he took the bread and he broke it. Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. Paul said, and in the same manner, meaning he took the cup, he gave thanks to God. He said, this cup is the New Testament. This is not about the Passover, see? This cup is the New Testament. Paul said in Hebrews, he said, and when he said that, the Old Testament waxed cold, meaning it came to an end. Because this is the New Testament in my blood, this do ye as oft as you do drink. Drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you show forth my death until I come. Saints, let me tell you what it's all about. You see, now for you and I, coming to this table symbolizes you coming, believing in the suffering and death of Jesus and what he did for you. I make it personal. See, it's for you. It's not a for us and a for we. It's what God did for you individually, which is to save you from your sins. And you come celebrating God's forgiveness and his grace as you receive God's gift of salvation. And from this moment on, you have fellowship with Jesus, who is sitting at the right hand of his Father. So you're here today, and you have not confessed the Lord Jesus Christ. Let me tell you, that night, all of that was for you, not for him. It was for us. So if you're here today, and you have not confessed the Lord Jesus Christ, the only thing I can say to you is come. Won't you come? Won't you come? Come to Jesus. Give God your heart. Huh? Give God your heart. And I'm talking about this. I'm not talking about this. Give God your heart. Huh? And for those who are online with us, of course, if you have made a decision to come to Christ, if you dial 703-494-4466, then at the conclusion of our worship service here, I'm going to join you on the phone, and we're going to pray and bless God for the salvation that is now yours. And of course, if you're not a part of a church family, that was the thing that I took from Stanley this morning. He told him, he said, you and I have a responsibility to join with a local and visible congregation. You can't just hang out there. You have to belong to, as we say, a church. So if God has placed it upon your heart to join with this branch of Zion, then why don't you come? We'd love to have you as part of our church family. And if you're online and you would make a decision to join with us, again, 703-494-4466, I'll join you on the line and we will pray and bless God for your decision to join with this body of believers. And if you need prayer, saints, not just here today, but anytime throughout the week, you can dial that same number that's on the screen. And our prayer warriors are going to reach out to you, and we're going to pray with you and for you for whatever is going on in your life. I just want to tell you, God is good. God is good. If you're here today and your lungs are filling with air, huh, and your heart is beating in rhythm, it's because God called you into time this morning, and he is sustaining your body that you might continue to give him praise, honor, and glory. God didn't keep us awake today for you and for me. God says it's because you got some work to do and the job is not finished. I thank God for your decision to be here with us today. I bless God for you. And I pray that as you go throughout this day and throughout this week, that God will protect you and he will keep you from all hurt, harm, or danger. But I would ask that you and I be faithful, that we abound in the work of the Lord until he allows us to come back together again, or he makes that decision to come back first. But I thank you for being here today. Father in heaven, we thank you. Now be with us, Lord, as we depart this place, that we might go forth to show forth your praises until you come back for us. And now may your grace, your mercy, and the sweet communion of your spirit forever rest, rule, and abide in our hearts, both now and forevermore. Join me as we sing together. Amen. To the table,
Jesus.
You know you need to go tell somebody. Thank you all so much. God bless you.